quiet silence of a heart that believes itself defeated by loss, by pain, by fear. Our hope nailed to a cross, our own faith depleted at the sight of no movement, a body inert. But it is not the end. At the sound of the gravestone rolling, a new story has unfolded. Death has been defeated. Our hope is alive. Jesus is alive. We raise our hands in victory. By his resurrection, we are set free. He blows a wind of life and brings us back to the light. He is risen. Our Messiah is alive. He breathes and the darkness trembles. He speaks and our future shines. By his sacrifice, we are now saved. By his grace, we can all rise. Here rejoicing in the sky, the grave could not hold him. The veil has been torn. Our Christ has won over death, over sin, over ache. By his power, all chains break. He is victorious. He is the way. He is the resurrection and the life. And by his wounds, we're made alive.
Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? 'Cause I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under. The dead thing's coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection. I see signs and I see wonders. I see birds of living color. The dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection.
Resurrection. Hands up, hands up.
Come alive. Come alive, wake up sleeper, he is risen, we are risen with him. Come alive, this flow wide open, he is risen, we are risen with him. Come alive, wake up.
The chance. chance to get to know you, the best way for us to do that is if you'd fill out one of these Connect cards. Fill that card out, drop it off at our Connect desk on your way out. We have a gift for you this morning, our way of saying thank you for coming and being a part of this. Does anybody else hear that? Anybody else hear something? I think I hear the sound of something rattling. Like something's about to come back to life. Do you hear it? Let's make some noise. Let's celebrate the resurrection this morning.
Do you hear what I hear?
I hear a sound.
I hear the sound.
My God is able to save and deliver and heal and restore anything that he wants to. Just ask the man who was thrown on the bones of Elijah if there's anything that he can do. Just ask the stone that was rolled out the tomb.
Love. Just know. Just know.
Savior,
eternity. The King of Life was on the moon. For in a dark old tomb, where our Lord was laid, one miraculous prayer, and we're forever changed. Oh, hail King Jesus. Yes, you are God. Risen. Oh, hail the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, hail King Jesus. Yes, he is. Oh, hail the Savior of the world. Savior of the world.
Special as today, God, we have the opportunity to remember the love that you shed on the cross for us, that blood that set us free. So in this moment, God, we raise our hands in unity and we just want to thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your dedication to our lives. We are made new. In this moment, God, we just want to open our hearts to you. Because we know that only you can reign. For when you tore the veil, you opened a communion for us to be able to worship you, God, to be able to pray to you directly. So God, we just come and we thank you. And we ask that in the same moment, God, that you prepare our hearts for what you have for us today, for the message that you will share with us. May it change us, may it transform us, so that we may leave here different than when we came in. In the name of Jesus Christ, together as a church, we say, amen. You may be seated.
Easter. The time where we celebrate the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. A time where we understand and it is made clear and evident to us that dead things can live again. And just like the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead now lives in us, come alive to the dead dreams. Come alive to the dead visions. Come alive to the dead relationships. Come alive to the dead marriages. Come alive to the dead lives and to the futures that lay barren. We believe that this resurrection life is in us, and we prophetically declare to everything in our life and in our future, come alive in Jesus' name.
Well, yeah. It is good to be here with you. You know what? Can I ask you guys to do something? We're out of space. And if it's possible, if you're sitting on the ends, if you could just kind of squish in, just if we have some people come in that need to find seats, we want to make sure that we can get them into those seats as easy as possible. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Well, it is Easter today, of course, and we are here to celebrate. And if there is one word that I would use to communicate what this day really is all about, it's the word hope. How many of you guys could use a little bit of hope this morning? Anybody out there? For sure. And when I think about the word hope, it actually reminds me of a plant called the crocus plant. Anybody know the crocus plant? All right, we've got a picture up there. This is actually a crocus plant that came up in my yard early this spring. And what I love about the crocus plant is it's the very first flower to bloom each spring. And in cold climates like New Jersey, oftentimes the cherry blossoms will bloom while there's still snow on the ground. I've got a picture of what that looks like. How cool is that? And it's fitting that we would be talking about the crocus on Easter, because crocuses come in Easter colors like purple and yellow and lavender and cream and white. And what I think is so interesting about the crocus plant is that it really gives us a picture of resurrection. What presents as death in winter comes to life in the spring, and it's hopeful. In fact, we we had a talented local artist who painted this image that you see on the screen to illustrate this idea. You look at the painting and you see it's barren, it's desolate, there's the skull, and this really represents the world that we live in. Think about it. The world is sort of unwinding, it's unraveling. Like, we're not getting better. Things aren't moving forward, and yet, in Christ, it reverses the curse, doesn't it? There's a resurrection, and you see that in this picture. This crocus there in the center of that barren, desolate land, and that's a picture of what Jesus' resurrection means to us. By the way, that local artist happens to be my daughter, Keegan, so thank you, Keegan. Yeah. And it seems like this crocus flower comes from out of nowhere at a time when it seems impossible for something to come alive. And it reminds me of what happened 2,000 years ago. And so this Easter, I want to invite you back to the moments just before the first Easter. In fact, before there was an Easter or even the idea of Easter. And the reason I want to take you back to this particular moment in history is that it may be the most compelling reason for why you should consider becoming a follower of Jesus. And so for the next few minutes, I'd like to take you back in time to a moment before there were any Christians, before there were any churches, before the Bible existed, a moment where there were mostly a couple of dozen, mostly Galilean men and women who found themselves bewildered and confused. It was history's darkest moment. It's the afternoon after Jesus' crucifixion, and Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, they're two respected citizens in Jerusalem. They go to Pilate and they ask Pilate permission for them to take the body of Jesus from the cross. Victims of the crucifixion were normally just left there to rot. You see, the goal of crucifixion wasn't just torture. It wasn't just death. The goal of crucifixion was oblivion. No one would know that you ever existed. You would just be erased without a trace. No grave, no place to mourn. And what was left of your body would be loaded onto a cart and taken out into the wilderness so the animals could just consume what was left. However, for the right price, occasionally the remains of a crucified body could be purchased. So these two prominent citizens risked their reputations to purchase Jesus' body. And the reason that we know this is because Matthew, Peter, and Luke tell us so. As two eyewitnesses and an investigative reporter, many years later, they write their accounts of what happened, and their words are included in a collection of ancient documents that we know as the Bible. So after retrieving his body, the two men, along with their servants, prepared the body for burial according to Jewish tradition, and then they placed it in a cave that would serve as a tomb. This meant that it could be sealed up with a large stone. Months or even years later, they would go back to that tomb. They would remove the bones and they would keep those bones. They would put them in a box called an ossuary. We keep people's ashes. They would keep people's bones. And so Joseph and Nicodemus, they had hoped that Jesus was who he claimed to be, as did all the first century followers. But now he's dead. Clearly, he was no Messiah. However, from their perspective, he had been tried and executed unjustly, and he didn't deserve the fate of a common criminal. So the least that they could do was ensure that he had a proper burial. And so they placed his body in the tomb, they sealed the opening, and they headed home. They had been wrong about this rabbi from Galilee. Meanwhile, 1,500 miles away in the eternal city of Rome, the Emperor Tiberius Caesar is there, and he has no idea what's going on in Judea at the time, which was actually considered the armpit of the empire. Saul of Tarsus, who we later come to know as the Apostle Paul, he's hundreds of miles north of Jerusalem, putting the final touches on his post-Passover message. Thomas, who would later earn the unfortunate nickname. You know what that is? Doubting Thomas. He had fled the city. Peter, James, John, the rest of the guys, they're huddled together and they're trying to figure out what they're going to do next. Peter's thinking of going back to his family's fishing business. Matthew really doesn't have any job prospects. In another part of town, there's a group of just devastated, broken-hearted women who were gathered, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, who without question was just shocked at what she had just witnessed. So there were confused citizens, there were frightened disciples, and there were broken-hearted women. But one thing you would not have found the afternoon before the first Easter was Christians. There were no Christians. There were no believers. There were no Jesus followers. Nobody believed Jesus was the Son of God. Nobody believed he was the Messiah that God had promised. He certainly wasn't a savior. He couldn't even save himself. And if Jesus couldn't keep himself alive, what was the point of keeping his movement alive? Clearly, Jesus wasn't who he claimed to be, which was the whole point of the movement. And this is so important. You see, Jesus' ministry didn't center around a new ideology or a call for social or religious reform. It wasn't like the civil rights movement or the Reformation. Jesus wasn't trying to reform or improve something. Jesus came to replace something. He came to establish something brand new, standalone, a new covenant. And he doesn't fit the model of a cultural warrior or a social activist. After all, most social movements are initially led by a charismatic leader, right? And he shows up or she shows up with what seems to be a new message and it appeals to the outcast and the disenfranchised. They show up when the culture is ripe for change, and when they die, their followers take up their cause and they keep their teaching alive. And history is full of examples like that. One would assume this would be the case with Jesus, right? He lived, he taught, he was executed, so surely his followers would take up his cause. They would continue to spread his message. They would keep his teaching alive, right? Wrong. And you should know that no credible historian embraces that theory. And no one who has read through the Gospels believes that either for two reasons. First of all, Jesus' message was not a message of liberation or revolution. It wasn't a popular message. In fact, Jesus' message didn't appeal to anyone. It was the opposite. He said things like, pay your taxes. No, thank you. Pray for your enemies. What? Lust equals adultery. Turn the other cheek. If someone asks for your coat, give them your shirt. Forgive regardless. His teachings were out of this world. He introduced a kingdom ethic that stood in sharp contrast to both the temple and the empire. In fact, most of the time when Jesus spoke, nobody had any idea of what he was talking about. Jesus didn't come to leave his followers with a collection of short stories or insights to pass on to the next generation. Judaism was already full of that sort of thing. Besides, Jesus never called his followers to trust his ideas. He asked his followers to trust in him, and that's the problem. And that's the second reason. While we know his followers weren't intent on keeping his movement alive, Jesus' message and ministry centered on him. It centered on what he claimed about and for himself. And this drove the religious leaders crazy. In the end, it wasn't his ideas or insights that got him crucified. It was who he claimed to be. He claimed authority that only God could have. He claimed authority to forgive sin. He claimed to be greater than Moses, greater than the temple, greater than the Sabbath, greater than all of the prophets. His teaching wasn't the driving force of the movement. It was his outrageous claims that he himself, about himself, that kept the band together and the movement moving. Jesus said things like, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live. Anyone who's seen me has seen the Father." On one occasion, Jesus preached a message that was so unpopular and confusing that the crowd started to grumble and disperse. His disciples were concerned as well, and so they started second-guessing Jesus. And so Jesus asked them, "What, do you want to leave now too?" Peter's response reiterates just how central Jesus' claims about himself were to his movement. Look at Peter's words. "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." Peter and the boys didn't choose to follow Jesus because of what he taught. They chose to follow Jesus in spite of what he taught. They followed Jesus because of who he claimed to be. But apparently, they had been wrong, because he's dead. And everybody knows the Holy One, the promised Messiah, the resurrection and the life can't die. The Son of God can't be killed. Clearly, Jesus wasn't who he claimed to be. So as the disciples watched him die, the movement died with them. And we know this the case because they write themselves into the story as unbelievers and unfollowers. There were no diehards. There were no heroes. Nobody expected Jesus to die, but when he did die, everybody expected him to stay dead. Nicodemus, Joseph, they prepared his body to stay dead. And on Easter, nobody's standing outside of the tomb counting down from 10. 10, 9. No, that's not what's happening. On the contrary, there's a group of women who leave home before dawn and they go out to that tomb to re-prepare Jesus' body for permanent burial. The point being, when Jesus uttered his last word, when he breathed his final breath, everybody believed who once believed stopped believing. Everybody who had hoped stopped hoping. The movement died when Jesus died because Jesus was the movement. Clearly, the gods had spoken. Or from the perspective of the Judean temple leaders, Yahweh had spoken. Whatever deity deserved the credit, the so-called miracle worker, blasphemer, storyteller from Nazareth was dead. And in an unprecedented series of events where the empire and the temple cooperated to rid themselves of this radical rabbi, and in doing so, they avoided yet another popular insurrection that would require the heavy-handed Roman intervention. Crisis averted. Now everything could go back to the way it was. So Pilate packs his bags, loads the family up into the Escalade or the carriage, whatever he had, heads back to his place at the shore, far away from the troublesome Judeans and the stench of the city. Let's pause there for a moment. Fast forward 350 years on February 27th in the year 380 AD. Roman Emperor Theodosius I issued a decree that made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire, to which we should respond, wait, what happened there? Hold on. Rome crucifies the leading figure of a Judean cult who was killed by his own people, or with the help of his own people. And 350 years later, this same discredited Galilean carpenter is now revered as God, but not just a God. Jesus of Nazareth has replaced all the Roman gods, the whole pantheon. And that's exactly what happened. Fast forward today, there's no Roman Empire, but If you visit the city of Rome, you'll see that that city is filled with crosses, not commemorating crucifixion, but a single crucifixion. And the Roman cross is no longer a symbol of suffering and shame, but it now represents hope and salvation. And for many of us here today, it represents love. And 1,500 miles away, in the old city of Jerusalem, it's filled with Christian tourists right now. They come from all over the world to walk where this discredited, crucified Galilean rabbi once walked. And if that's all you knew, a troublesome rabbi was rejected by his own people and crucified by Rome. Then 350 years later, that same troublesome rabbi is considered God by Rome. In 1,700 years after that, hundreds of millions of people in just about every nation in the world consider him divine, and they gather weekly to recognize and celebrate his lordship. If that was all you knew, by the way, all three of those things are historically indisputable. He was crucified by Rome and then later embraced by Rome. And here we are. And if that's all you knew, what is the question that begs to be asked? What's the question? You know, if you were at the park, maybe Veterans Park or Mercer County Park, and you notice a sweet little girl there with who you assume to be her mother, and you comment to the mom on how cute her daughter is, and she smiles and she says, "Thank you. I'm lucky to still have her." You see, last year, she was over at the neighbor's house and playing on their trampoline, and she fell off and she hit her head and she stopped breathing. The paramedics showed up on scene and they pronounced her dead. Then she looks down at her daughter and brushes her hair out of her face. And that was it. She just smiles. What's the question that begs to be asked? What happened, right? Clearly, there's something missing. Fill in the gap. Something happened between she stopped breathing and this precious little girl that's sitting on the bench. When it comes to the story of Jesus, the same question begs to be asked. What happened? There's a gap. The story doesn't make sense. Something is missing. Something's been left out. And the question that we all must ask, and perhaps the question that you've never thought to ask or been challenged to ask, is what happened? What happened between the crucifixion and a movement that engulfed an empire and circled the world? Clearly, there's more to the story. In fact, without the more, the story doesn't make sense. And the more of the story is why we're here today. The more to the story is why there's a story to begin with. Clearly, something happened. Fortunately, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they describe what happens. John, in his own words, tells us what happens early on the Sunday morning following the Passover. He writes, "While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him.'" So Mary goes to the tomb. It's empty. She sees Peter and John. She says, "Listen, somebody stole the body of Jesus. What do we do?" You see, nobody assumed a miracle. Nobody expected the resurrection. They expected Jesus to do what dead people do, that's stay dead. And this would have been the perfect opportunity for the writers of the Gospels to write themselves into the stories as the ones who stayed faithful, who stayed true. But they don't do that because that's not what happened. Luke, who interviewed the disciples later, writes this. He says, "But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense." They're thinking, what have they been smoking? I mean, what is going on here? They don't believe it. They're not expecting a miracle. They're not expecting the resurrection. So what happens next? John tells us. So Peter and the other disciple, by the way, the other disciple, his name is John. He's the one writing this. They started running for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter. Don't you love that? That's such a guy thing. Like, did he really have to make that known that he was faster than Peter? And so he reached the tomb first. Just note that. Verse 5, he bent over and looked in at the strips of the linen lying there. He's like peeking around the corner, but he did not go in. He was faster, but not braver. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. You know, Peter was already always ready to act, right? And he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and he believed. The tomb's empty. The body is not there. At that moment, the light goes off. The understanding comes. Wow, he was who he claimed to be. Later, Jesus appears to his followers in that band of unremarkable men and women, re-engaged with the message and the mission of their Lord. But they didn't re-engage with what Jesus taught. They didn't re-engage, or simply because of what Jesus taught. They didn't re-engage because of something they believed. They re-engaged because of what happened, because of what they witnessed, because of what they saw. It was their resurrected rabbi, friend, savior. Paul reiterating the importance of and the centrality of what happened with Jesus' resurrection writes this: if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. Apart from that single solitary event, apart from what happened, your faith is just a fairy tale. The Christian faith, the church, and all that we as Christians hold dear are held together by a single event, the resurrection of Jesus. What happened? What makes sense of what happened? Jesus rose from the dead. That's what happened. That's the missing piece of the puzzle. That's what completes the picture. That's what breathed life and hope and courage back into his flailing followers. The resurrection of Jesus isn't one of the Bible stories. The resurrection of Jesus is the story. According to Paul and according to history, apart from the resurrection, there would be no story to tell. No one would have bothered to document the story of Jesus. His life would have been reduced to a few sentences in the ancient history books. Apart from the resurrection, there would be no church, there would be no Bible, there would be no hope. So every time, every year this time, we pause to celebrate and remember that the reason we believe is because something happened. And we're reminded that the question to which we must fasten our faith is, what happened? What happened fills in the gap in the story. What happened explains why Rome embraced a criminal as Lord. It explains why a crucified Galilean is worshipped by over one-third of the modern world's population. What happened is Easter happened. Jesus rose from the dead. And that event sparked the movement that we know today as the church, that eventually brought us the Bible. And the resurrection of Jesus solves several of history's greatest mysteries and explains why there's so much detail around the life of Jesus that survived the first century. It explains why the followers of Jesus suddenly regained their courage. It explains why the early church survived dual persecutions, both from the temple and from the empire. But the resurrection of Jesus also solves another great mystery. And it's a personal mystery. It's the mystery of where do we stand with God? You see, the only person who ever lived and spoke with certainty and authority on that topic is Jesus of Nazareth. And he was clear and he spoke with such authority that people marveled and the religious leaders trembled. His first century audience had every right to be skeptical. But if someone claims to speak for God and then predicts their death and resurrection and pulls it off, we should pay attention to what that person has to say. And here's what he had to say about where you stand with God. John, the other disciple who beat Peter to the empty tomb but hesitated to rush in, he writes this: "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." In an unprecedented move and a turn of events that Jesus predicted, but his followers missed, and in a twist that no one anticipated, his resurrection punctuated the point of his crucifixion. His secret ambition was to die so you could live. And he perished and was lost to God, so you don't have to be. You see, death had lost its sting for all who would believe. The crucifixion made no sense until Easter, and then it made all the sense in the world because it validated his claim to be the ransom for many and the savior of the world. And on a personal level, it validated his authority to forgive sin, your sin and my sin. So if you're a Jesus follower and you're here today, the resurrection of Jesus means you have peace with God. Your prayers are heard, your faithfulness matters, your generosity counts. And if you're here today or you're watching this message today and you're not yet a follower of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus provides you with a reason to believe and a reason to follow. One of those claims is that God loves you. You see, Christianity is not a faith in faith. It is faith in a person who demonstrated through his life, death, and resurrection that he is worthy of your devotion. Not because of something that was written, but because of something that happened. Jesus of Nazareth rose from the dead. And as we close today, I'd like to extend the same invitation that Peter extended to the citizens of Jerusalem when they acknowledged who Jesus was, that he was in fact who he claimed to be. Peter invited them, and I invite you today. This is what he invites them. He says, "Repent and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from Jesus our Lord." And while I was sharing that story, if it dawned on you that what I was saying is true, I want to invite you to express your faith to God through a prayer. And so I'm going to ask everybody in the room right now to bow your heads and close your eyes. And if today you recognize what it is that Jesus did on the cross and what it was that was made possible through his resurrection, and today you want to experience new life, eternal life, a new birth with him, then today I invite you right now to pray this prayer with me right where you're sitting. Just have a conversation with God from your heart to his. Say something like this: "Heavenly Father, I see now what I've missed. I believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be. I repent of my sins and I'm turning to you, God. I place my trust in you today as my Savior and as my Lord. And I believe Jesus' death served as the full and final payment for my sins. Today, I accept your gift of salvation, new life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you prayed that prayer this morning and you meant it, you turned your heart to God, you're leaving behind trying to get to God on your own, you're leaving behind your sin and you're turning to God, would you just lift your hand right now? Let me know you prayed that prayer. Amen. I see that hand, I see that hand. I see the hand in the back there. I see that hand in the left, in the middle, in the back. I see those two back there. Thank you. Others, you'd say, yeah, I see your hand. Thank you. I see your hand in the back. Thank you. Others over here on the right. Yep, I see those hands. Thank you. You'd say, today I made that declaration. I believe in a resurrected Savior who has resurrected. Amen. Well, you can look up. Thank you. You know, the Bible says that when one sinner, that's all of us, comes to repentance, turns to God, that all of heaven celebrates that. So can we join them right now? Amen. And I want to say to you all who made that decision to follow Jesus today, welcome to the family. And we consider it our responsibility to help you in your spiritual journey. We have a gift for you this morning. We'd love to give you a Bible and a little book to help you understand what it means to follow Jesus. And so if you just stop by our Connect desk on your way out, just say, hey, can I have one of those Bibles? You don't have to give them your name, fill out a card, just nothing. Just ask them and they will give you that today as a gift. Also on your way out, we're going to give a gift to you. We have for each of you a crocus bulb. You say, well, what's a crocus bulb for? Well, what I want you to do, if you're so inclined, you'll have to do this, but I would encourage you to take this bulb home and plant it in the ground somewhere. Doesn't really matter where, but just an inch or two underneath the surface, put that bulb in the ground. And probably what's gonna happen, according to my wife, who has a green thumb and loves plants, next year, sometime around early March, you're gonna see that crocus plant come to life, and it's gonna feel like everything's dead and desolate, but that new life is gonna come through. And I want that to be a reminder to you of the new life, of the resurrection that we have because of Jesus, amen? So we'll send you with that today. Before I dismiss you all, so I want to invite you all to come back next week. We are kicking off a brand new series called Peace of Mind, where we're going to be talking about mental health issues. And what we're going to see together is that some familiar names in Scripture dealt with many of the same struggles that we face today. And we're going to learn how they overcame those struggles, not through their own strength, but by depending on God. And so if you've been affected by mental health, maybe you struggle with anxiety or depression, one of those things, or somebody you love does, and can we be honest, that's every person in this room, right? We've all been touched by this issue. Let's talk about it. I know it's an issue that's often neglected, but we're not going to do that here at the Bridge Church. We believe God wants to meet all of our needs, including those of our mental health. And so I invite you to come and be part of that. Make sure to be back next week. And following the 12 o'clock service next week, we're going to be having a block party. We're going to have our giant inflatables out for the kids, not for you adults, for the kids, chips, hot dogs, cornhole. It's going to be a fun time to hang out, make some connections, and hopefully make some new friends as well. We're going to give you some cards to remind you of that or to share with someone else to invite them back next week. We say this every week here at the Bridge Church, and we say this as a reminder to us that the church is not a building. The church is not a location. The church is a people. The church is a movement. We are the church. Amen. And so I want to hear you say this, and I want to hear you say it with some Easter passion. All right. Little extra mustard in the sauce. I don't know if that's the right word, but you know what I'm saying, right? Can you say this with me? All right, here we go. We've been the church here. Now let's go be the church out there. You are dismissed. Happy Easter.